Amen and amen. Welcome back to Black Oak Baptist Church on a Sunday night. Trust and pray that you've had a great afternoon in the Lord. What a blessed day we've had so far, looking for great things from the Lord tonight. I'm going to ask you to stand, follow along and sing on the screen. We're going to sing a couple songs, and we got a little surprise for you tonight. Holy, holy, holy.
From the waters lifted me, I say, am I lost?
Amen. Brother Tommy and Brother Rocky's going to continue to play. You step out, shake someone's hand, make them feel welcome at church tonight. Would you do that? Seated this afternoon. I come into church this afternoon. Drama team was up here practicing. I said, you might as well just go ahead and try it out tonight, right? So it's a new song for them. They ain't practiced it much, maybe 40 times. Something like that. But you'll like it. Drama team, come on. Then after that, Brother Matthew's going to come and preach.
Verdict was guilty, case closed, the end. No chance for me to ever leave this prison of my sin. Now I know it might sound crazy, but one day a key unlocked that cell. I heard a small voice say your debt's been paid by somebody else. And now I'm walking, walking, walking. Nothing perfect. I still stumble every single day. still get knocked down, but the difference now is that's not where I stay. Cause I got a savior who knows everywhere I've been, and he's telling me that I never have to go back there again. So now I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt, and lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell at my feet. And now I'm walking, walking, walking free, walking free. Walking free. To the one walking wounded, and to the one with regret, look up and see your victory is just up ahead. Cause there is a savior who knows everywhere you've been, and he's telling you that you never have to go back there again. So if you know that you never have to go back there again, then sing, I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more.
They've been practicing real hard for Faith Family and Fireworks. We didn't get out of here till after 2 o'clock, and they's back over here at 4 o'clock already. So they've been working hard. Take your Bibles with me tonight to Mark chapter number 6. Well, this morning was good, wasn't it? Amen. Still rejoicing over the soul that was saved. It's been a good day. After services like this morning, you can go home and rest a little bit, and it's all right. Amen. If you took a nap today, say amen. Amen. Yeah. Mark chapter 6 tonight. We find ourselves in a very familiar passage of Scripture that the Lord's put upon my heart. Would you stand with us tonight if you can? Honor and reverence as we read the Word of God. Begin reading in the 45th verse of Mark chapter number 6. The Bible says, "And straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethsaida, while he sent away the people. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And he saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them, walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, and they supposed it had been a spirit, and cried out, for they all saw him and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them and said unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And he went up unto the mount, them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. For they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. And when they had passed over, they came into the land of Gennesaret, and drew to the shore. And when they were come out of the ship, straightway they knew him, and ran through the whole region round about, and began to carry about in beds those that were sick, and they heard who he was. And whithersoever he entered into the villages or cities or country, they laid the sick in the streets, and besought him that they might touch, if it were but the border of his garment, and as many as touched him were made whole." Father, I thank you for your word tonight. God, thank you for what you have done in this place today. God, thank you for the wonderful worship and service that you gave us this morning. And God, I pray tonight that you would give us tonight's bread. Lord, I know that all of us in here, God, have walked through storms, or Lord, maybe we're walking through a storm right now. But God, I pray that you'd comfort our hearts through your word. Lord, help me to communicate what you put in my heart for tonight. Lord, I know that I can't do anything without your help, so I just ask you to sit me to the side. And God, I ask you to preach to us tonight for your honor and for your glory. God, encourage that person who's down today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. I'd like to preach a thought like this tonight with the Lord's help. I've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for me. Here in Mark chapter number 6, we find ourselves in a very familiar passage of Scripture. We find ourselves, I've preached several times from this passage in the Gospel of Matthew, and the Gospel of John will tell us the same story with just some different aspects of it. I begin to think about the Gospel of Mark today just in some study. The Gospel of Mark, you know, if you're a Bible student, it is Jesus on the move. Mark does not give us a genealogy of the Lord Jesus Christ. He does not give us the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that is all because he is writing to Roman Christians. He's writing to those in Rome. So I kind of like his preaching style. He just hits the ground running and he tells us the story. And so it doesn't take him long to get into the ministry of Jesus. And by chapter number 6, Jesus' ministry has been going on for some time already. Matter of fact, the disciples, the 12 of them, they've been called, they've been commissioned, they've been sent out, and they've already got to experience some great and mighty things. But how many of you know that it's when you're on the mountaintop in life that you need to watch your back, because it's on the mountaintop where everything seems to be going good. On the mountain, everything seems to be well, but just over the hill is another valley. And the Christian life tonight is that of hills and valleys. I may go on to say sometimes it's more valleys than it is hills, but praise God, one day we'll get home and we'll be on the mountain forever. They find themselves in a storm, but it's not the first storm. If you look actually in Mark chapter number 5, they were in a storm before Mark chapter number 6. And in that storm, they got some experience because Jesus walked upon the water to them and he said, "Peace, be still." Now, may I remind you tonight that the majority of the disciples were fishermen. Andrew and Peter and James and John were keeping their father's nets in their boats. You remember they were fishing that day. And Jesus walked by and he said, "Cast your nets on the other side." And you remember that they did, and they got a great multitude of fish. The Bible said so much so that it couldn't be numbered. And they began to draw that net in, but it broke because the fish were so great. And you remember they marveled that day. Jesus also got in Simon Peter's boat. And he said, "Simon Peter, cast away from the shore a little bit." And it was the custom in that day for the rabbi to sit down while he was teaching. I can't sit down while I'm teaching because I'm too fidgety. I move around all over the place. But Jesus sat down and he taught in the ship that day from Simon Peter's boat. And when he got back on the shore, Peter fell on his knees before the Lord. You remember that sermon about 3 months ago we preached? And he said, "Depart from me, for I am a man of unclean lips." He had a realization of who Jesus was. Have you had a realization tonight of who Jesus is in your life? And they started to follow him, but they knew the Sea of Galilee. Brother Jack, you've been there. God willing, I'm going soon. You know how big that is, and I've learned you could probably tell us more that it's like a great amphitheater by the mountain that surrounds it. And on the Sea of Galilee that day, a storm arose. But you remember that Jesus just fed the 5,000, and he departed into the mountain to pray. But the Bible said that Jesus constrained his disciples to go to the other side. What that simply means tonight is Jesus told the disciples to get into the boat and go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and he said, "I will meet you there." But Jesus was teaching the disciples that they could have faith in who he is and that they could trust him. Can I say it like this tonight? Preacher, I'm not in a storm tonight. Well, pack a lunch, because in the Christian life, you're either going into a storm, you're in a storm, or you're coming out of a storm. Every one of us have things that we face, but I've just decided tonight that I've been through enough that I know that He'll be enough for me. And that's an old song tonight. You may have recognized it. But the disciples get there that day. The Master has departed into the mountain to pray. And may I say that while they's in the storm, He was praying for them. And they got in that boat and they started to go to the other side. And the winds got contrary and they started to blow. And the storm rolled in. Now these were experienced fishermen. They knew how to handle the sea. But it was in that moment that they cried out with fear. And Jesus came walking on the water. Can you see it in your mind's eye tonight? He knew right where they were. Dear friend, you may be in a storm tonight, but He knows right where you are. And He came walking down on the water to them that day. And the Bible said that they cried out in fear, for they thought that it was a ghost. I want you to look there again in verse number 46. It said, before I get ahead of myself, He had sent them away. He departed into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and He alone on the land. Watch this. And He saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, He cometh unto them, walking upon the sea. And He would have passed them by. Did you catch that? They was in a boat. He was on land, but He saw them toiling and rowing. He saw them fighting against the storm, just trying to get to safety. You know what I watch people do sometimes? I watch church people sometimes. I've done it myself. You fight with everything you've got. You're toiling and you're rowing, and you're just trying to get out of the storms of life. But the whole time your lifeguard walks on water, and he's saying, peace be still. He's trying to get you out of the storm. You ain't got to get yourself out of the storm tonight. And He saw them toiling and rowing. Look in verse 49. But when they saw Him walking upon the sea, they supposed it was a spirit, and they cried out. Can you see Jesus is walking on the water in the midst of the storm on the Sea of Galilee to where that little dinky boat is? And they cried out. They weren't crying out asking that thing for help. They thought it was a ghost. They thought it was a spirit, and they crying out for fear. But the next verse makes me happy. Look at verse 50. It said, when they saw Him, they were troubled, and immediately He talked with them and said unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. Has He ever said that to any of you? I've been plenty of storms in my life. I remember last year we was on vacation, and I remember it just like spiritual warfare broke out in my heart. And I remember Brother Roger in that time, I was getting ready. He's about to drive back home, and as clear as I'm talking to you, the Holy Ghost said, for I have not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. This week I was getting ready for Sunday morning. God told me to do that, though it was different, and I was fighting every demon in hell I felt like this week. And Brother Daniel's helping me trim some trees the other day, and before he got there, I walked in my garage, and the Holy Ghost said, Matthew, it's only spiritual warfare. And he began to remind me that he's disarmed principalities and powers, that he's removed every weapon from the enemy. He began to remind me that no weapon formed against you will prosper. I'm telling you, in the storms of your life, Jesus is not running away from you, but he's running to you. What about that song they sung this morning, that father sat on the porch and he waited for that prodigal son to come home? But you know what I found? Every time I found myself in the hog pen of this world, every time I found myself fighting against this world, there's been a father that's ran right to where I'm. I'm going to need some of y'all to help me. I ran right to where I was and picked me up and set my feet on a rock. You know why I'm preaching this tonight? I can't tell you how many times God's reached down and lifted me out of the mire and put a new song in my heart and established my goings. Anybody ever been through enough to know that he'll be enough? Preacher, what do you mean? Let me tell you tonight. Not only were the disciples in the storm in the Sea of Galilee, if your Bible's still open, I want you to turn back to Mark chapter 4 with me. I want you to follow track with me just for a little while tonight. In Mark chapter number 4, I'll show you what the Lord's shown me, and I'll sit down. In Mark chapter number 4, they'd been through enough, Brother Roger, to know that he'd be enough, but they didn't yet have it figured out. Mark chapter number 4, they found themselves after Jesus taught about the parable parables of the kingdom. They found themselves. They were passing over to the other side, but this time Jesus was in the boat with them, and another storm arose, and he's down in the stern, and he's asleep, and they begin to say, "Master, do you not care that we perish?" You know what that makes me think of? A child, your cries have awoken the master. They went downstairs, and they said, "Master, do you not care that we perish?" And he rose up and said, "Where is your faith?" And he said, "Peace, be still." And the storm stopped. And they said, "What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Not only did God show them that, but Brother Rocky in Mark chapter number 5, they's in that land of Gennesaret, and that man that was possessed with the devil, you remember, he said his name was Legion, for the many demons that were in him. And he was cutting himself in the tombs that day. The Bible said they tried to bind him with fetters and chains, but he'd break out of them every time. But in walked a man named Jesus, and before Jesus ever said a word, the demon cried out, and he said, "What have I to do with thee, Jesus of Nazareth?" And Jesus said, "Come out of him." And that very moment he did, the disciples watched that happen. Can you see what I'm trying to tell you tonight? They watched the power that Jesus has over the enemy. In Mark chapter number 5, a man named Jairus came to Jesus. Said, "Master, my daughter lieth at home sick, and you're her only hope." But in that moment, now I'm going to show you something you need to remember for the end of this message. In that moment, there's a lady who'd been suffering for 12 years of a certain blood issue. She saw all the doctors that she could see. And in that day, the Bible said she spent all that she had just trying to get some help. And she crawled on her hands and her knees to Jesus and touched but the hem of his garment. Can I say it like this tonight? If you're hanging on by him, just make sure it's by the hem of his garment, and it'll be enough to get you through tonight. Immediately the blood was stanched and she was healed, and Jesus turned around and he said, "Who touched me?" And the disciples said, "Master, there's a multitude thronging thee, and you ask who touched you." He said, "I felt virtue leave my body." And that woman said, "It was me." Did you notice what happened over in chapter number 6? I'm going to go ahead and tell you. In verse 56, it said, "And whithersoever he entered into villages or cities, they laid him the sick in the streets and besought that they might touch, if it were but the border of his garment." How do you think they knew that that'd be enough to help? I guarantee you there's a lady running around who had been bound and sick for a long time, saying, "I just touched the hem of his garment and it made me whole." I guarantee you everybody said, "If I can just do that, I can be whole tonight." The disciples watched all of this. Are you getting the picture tonight? They saw what Jesus could do. Jairus' servants came and said, "Master, your daughter's dead. Trouble Jesus no further." You know what Jesus said? "Be not afraid. Only believe." He walked right beside Jairus back to his home, and he was a ruler that day, and he got to Jairus' home, and you know what it said? That the servants outside, in Bible times, they would hire people that would come. Scholars tell us to these situations, and they were called weepers, and they would weep and they would wail. In situations like this, they would mourn. And when Jesus walked in, you can read this in all of your Gospels and get the full account. When Jesus walked in, they said, they laughed at him, and he put them out of the room. And you know what he said to that little girl? He said, "Arise." And she got up. Preacher, what are you telling me tonight? That the disciples had watched firsthand of the power of God, and that you ought to think they'd been through enough to know that he would be enough for them. But they found themselves in another storm of the lie of life, and they began to cry out in fear again. But the Bible told us why there in verse 50 number 2. It said that they considered not the miracles of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. Not only did they watch Jesus cast out the demons, not only did they watch him heal Jairus' daughter and the lady with the blood issue, but they watched Jesus take some merely little fish and loaves and feed a crowd of 5,000 people. Can you remember reading that? They said, "Master, we don't have enough food, and we ain't got enough money to go into town." Can I say tonight, little is much when God is in it? And they took that bread and he blessed it and he broke it and they sat them down. And by the way, it was only 5,000 men. That doesn't number the mothers and the children. I mean, they watched the power of God. But when they got in a storm, they forgot about it all. How many times when we get in the storms of life, we forget what he did? Dear friend, if you're going to live the Christian life and you're going to fight the good fight, you have to remember in the dark what God showed you in the light. It said they considered not, verse 53, when they passed by over, they came unto that land and they drew to the shore. They still aren't realizing what's going on. They still aren't realizing, Brother Jack, just what's happened. That their lifeguard comes walking on water. If you read Matthew's account of this in Matthew chapter number 14, Jesus said the same thing, be of good cheer, as I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto the water. And Peter got out of the boat, and he was on the water with Jesus. I was thinking about that song they sung this morning, get out of the boat. Some of us need to get out of the boat this morning and live by faith and quit trying to walk by sight. Peter got out of the boat, but he took his eyes off of Jesus in the middle of the storm, and he started to sink. I can't tell you how many times I've taken my eyes off of Jesus, Brother Don, when everything was going wrong, and I said, oh, you know what, I'll just fix it on my own. But you know what Peter did when he went under the water? He said, he cried out, Lord, save me. And the Bible didn't say in a moment or in a few minutes, but immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand under the water and pulled Peter up. Ain't God ever done that for anybody in here tonight? You felt like you was going to drown. You felt like everything was crashing in. But just in time, there was a hand that reached down for you and picked you up and put you on your feet and put a new song in your heart. I'm telling you, everything we've been through ought to be enough to know that he'll be enough for everything we will go through. But they weren't quite there yet. I thought about some other people today. I was talking to the Lord today, and I said, Lord, what about Moses? Lord, you called him. You remember he's just there that day in Exodus chapter number 3, and he's keeping his father-in-law's sheep on the backside of the desert. And you remember he walked by that bush that day and it was on fire. And it wasn't a normal thing for a bush to be on fire, but more than that, the bush was not consumed. And Moses drew near him. There was a voice that called out and said, take your shoes off or you're on holy ground. Don't you like this morning services like that when we can get on holy ground and we can feel God blow through the place? And Moses drew near to the bush, and the Lord said, I'm calling you to deliver my people, for I've heard their cries of affliction. And Moses gave all the excuses in the world, and you know that story, but he sent Aaron with him, and he went down there, and he began to tell Pharaoh that there was a God a lot bigger than him that was going to deliver his people. Moses said, Lord, what do I say to him? He said, you just tell him, I am that I am has sent you. You know what Moses watched, Brother Roger? He watched the 7 plagues fall on Egypt and not touch Israel. You know what he watched? That last plague, they got that blood and they applied it on Passover to the lintel post of the doors, and the death angel passed over and they were all alive, but the firstborn of the Egyptians died. You know what Moses watched that night? He watched God open up the gates of bondage as millions of Israelites left Egypt after 400 years. You know what he did? He watched God provide water from a rock. You know what he did, Brother Rocky? He watched manna and quail fall from heaven. He watched God provide everything that they needed. And more than that, when there arose a disobedient generation and they said God hadn't given us that promised land, those 10 spies, you know what Moses saw? The Bible said they wandered for 40 years, but their shoes didn't wear out and their clothes didn't wear out. I'm telling you about a God that provided. You know what Moses could say? I believe he said it on Mount Pisgah. You remember he didn't get to go on the promised land. The people provoked him to disobedience. But I thought about it today as he stood on the mountain of Mount Pisgah and he looked over into the promised land. I wonder if he said, I've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for me. I wonder if he said, he's all that I need. I thought about Elijah. One of my favorite stories is 1 Kings chapter number 19. Elijah's having a pity party under the juniper tree. I have pity parties sometimes. Sometimes Haley will say, "You having a pity party?" I say, "Yeah, you're not invited. I'm going to pout myself." I have those moments under the juniper tree sometimes. Do you? You remember God provided for him, put him to sleep, gave him a cake baking on the coals and a cruise of water, the Bible said. And you remember that after that, that Elijah went into the cave and he still thought he was all alone. And he began to talk to the Lord and he said, "Lord, I'm the only one that you've got left. I'm the only one that hasn't bowed the knee to Baal." And you remember the Lord spoke to him and said, "Elijah, I've got 7,000 outside there that haven't bowed the knee to Baal. Can I take a side note and say there's still more with us than there is with them?" It may seem like Christians are getting scarce in this world, but as Curtis Hudson sung, "I'm still on the winning side, and one day I'm going home." But you know what Elijah did? He walked out to the edge of the cave, and there's a great earthquake. Fire fell from heaven. There was a great wind, but the Bible said that the Lord was not in it. But there's a still small voice that said, "Elijah, what are you doing here?" You know what he did when he walked out? I believe he said, "I've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for me." He picked back up the gospel torch. He walked out to where Elisha was keeping the oxen, and he threw the mantle on him. And that'll roll us right over. I thought about Elisha. Are y'all with me tonight? Say amen. I thought about Elisha when he was standing up on the mountain and the army of Syria was surrounding where he was. I thought about his young little servant boy that said, "Master, what are we going to do?" And he said, "Lord, open his eyes." And they saw chariots of fire surrounding the mountain. Can you imagine that? I probably would have ran a lap. If I saw that, I'd probably get on top of the pews. Amen. And you know what happened that day? I believe Elisha looked over at that young servant and he said, "Hey, now you've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for everything that you need." I thought about some more tonight. Is it okay if I keep going? Y'all want preaching tonight? I thought about some other places tonight. I thought about blind Bartimaeus. In chapter number 10, sitting by the wayside, didn't have nobody to help him. He was blind, but he could sense when Jesus walked by. And in Mark 10:48, he cried out, and he said, "The Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus said, "What would you that I do unto you?" And he said, "Just have faith." And you know what he did? He gave blind Bartimaeus his sight back. I wonder if blind Bartimaeus was walking around town saying, "He's more than enough for me." If that ain't enough for you tonight, I thought about the 10 lepers. I was having church at my desk just a little while ago. I thought about the 10 lepers that they came to Jesus and asked to be healed. And Jesus said, what was according to the law that day? He said, "Go show yourself to the priest and be made whole." And buddy, all 10 of them went their way. But one of them turned around and he went back and he fell at the feet of Jesus and he just began to thank him for all that he had done. I might be speculating tonight, but that man was an outcast. He was dirty like we saw this morning, but now he was clean. I just wonder in the reservoirs of my soul if he said, "I've been through enough to know that he'll be enough for me." Have you been enough to know that he'll be enough for you tonight? I thought about Peter in Acts chapter number 12. Before that, I thought about the disciples in Acts chapter number 4. What, you know what I've learned in the Christian life? That after my greatest victory comes my greatest defeat. Preacher, what do you mean? Elijah just prayed fire down from heaven, consumed every prophet of Baal. You remember they's on that mountain, and I won't stay here long, but I like this story. You remember, well, it's not a story, it's history. It really happened. But you know what happened in that moment? That they set up their altar and those prophets of Baal, Brother Jack began to cry out for their God to send fire. And they, you remember they started to cut themselves. And Elijah took and he rebuilt the altar and he dug a trench about it. And he poured water all over it. The ground was soaking wet. And he began to tease them prophets of Baal. And he said, "Is your God asleep? Maybe he's taking care of other business." And all Elijah said was, "God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I know that you hear me, but to prove that you're the God of this land, let fire come down and consume the sacrifice." And it licked up every drop of the water. But after that, Jezebel said, "I'm going to do to everything to you that you've done to the prophets of Baal." And before Elijah knew it, he went from being on the mountain to being in the valley. Can I tell you, after services like this morning, is when I go from being on the mountain and Monday morning rolls around, and I'm back down in the valley, and I've got to remind myself of what he did over yonder, and I've got to tell myself that I've been through enough to know that he is more than enough for me. Acts chapter number 3, Pentecost happens. Over 5,000 people get saved. Wouldn't that be wonderful to see that today? You believe God still do that? I sure do. You remember what happened? Acts chapter number 4, persecution. You know what? Greatest victory, greatest defeat. They's in the jail cells. They's whipping them. They's persecuting them for preaching about Jesus, and they said, we're going to let you go. And you remember from about Acts chapter number 4 to where Brother Dawson preached last Sunday morning to Acts chapter number 9, you remember that they faced persecution. But you know what them disciples did every time they let them go? They said, don't speak about Jesus no more. They went right back to the synagogue and the temple and started to preach Christ crucified and risen again. You know why they did that? Because he was more than enough for them. They didn't give it. What about Acts chapter number 12? I hope y'all are okay tonight. Acts chapter number 12, Peter's in the prison. He's locked up. One of the disciples had just been killed, and Herod said that he was next, that they would get Peter the next day. But all the other disciples were over in John Mark's mom's house, and the Bible said that they's praying for God to deliver Peter. You know what happened in the prison that day? I love this story. I love this part, that the angel came in, a light shone round about him, and said, Peter, gird yourself and put your sandals on and follow me. He was chained to other guards, if you read it, and God broke the chains of his bondage, delivered him. Peter said that when he got outside the last ward, he finally realized that he wasn't having a dream. I wonder in my mind, I think of Peter kind of as a manly man, but I wonder if he just wasn't skipping over to John Mark's house and saying, I'm going to tell them other disciples that I've come through another battle. I've come through another valley. I've come through another storm. I just came tonight to tell you, if God brings you to it, he'll bring you through it. And Peter came and he knocked on the door, and the damsel came, and she opened and saw it was Peter. She slammed the door back in his face. She ran to where the others were, and she said, Peter's outside. And they said, no way, he's outside. Can I tell you, if you pray in faith, you better expect God to do something. And Peter's still standing at the door. Maybe, just maybe, I don't know, maybe he's shouting in the house and saying, hey, guys, he's still more than enough for me. Anybody ever been through some things? When you come to that same valley, maybe you come to that same storm on the Sea of Galilee, and you realize he brought you through it last time. He can bring you through it again. When that depression hits you out of nowhere, when that anxiety flares up, and you think, wait a second, God was faithful then. And Hebrews 13:8 says he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So if God can do it then, he can do it today. If God can deliver his people in his word, he can deliver us today. We just finished the study on the book of Acts. Do you know why that the church age did not end in the book of Acts? Because it's still being written. I'm almost done tonight. Can I tell you one more? I thought about Paul. I thought about him going from Saul to Paul. I thought about that transformation that happened in Acts chapter number 9. But I thought about after that. I remember right after that, that they started trying to kill him. And you remember the disciples had to lower him in a basket down the wall outside of Jerusalem. And you know where the first place Paul went back to is Tarsus, from where he came from. I just imagine he went back to tell everybody what happened. And he began to minister, and they began to try to kill him from that moment forward. And you know what happened after that? That he faced persecution after persecution. You remember him and Silas got in the prison that day. I don't know who knew what, but Brother Paul, maybe Silas said, hey, why don't you just sing us one? And I've told you this before, maybe he just started singing for a long time. I traveled down a long lonely road. My heart was so heavy and sin I sank low. But then I heard about Jesus. What a wonderful hour. I'm so glad that I found out He would bring me out through His saving power. Maybe He said, thank God I am free, free, free from this world of sin. I've been washed in the blood of Jesus. I've been born again. Hallelujah, I'm safe, safe, safe by His wonderful grace. I'm so glad that I found out He would bring me out and show me the way. Maybe about that time's when the chains fell off. Now, for you, for those, preacher, you don't know what they sang. You don't either, so I'm just going to think what I want. Maybe just in that moment they started to sing. Maybe before John Newton ever wrote it, maybe they started to sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. But either way, they singing and the chains fell off and an earthquake came and opened the doors of the prison and they was free. I mean, Paul had experienced some things and he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy, do your diligence to come before winter, because he knew that he would be executed in that time. And he told him, I have fought the good fight, I have kept the faith, I have finished my course. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of glory, which the righteous judge shall give me in that day. But you know what Paul said about that thorn that was in his flesh in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9? The Lord said unto him, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. My mind just wonders that in that dungeon in Rome, at the end of his life, Brother Tommy, he only served God. He was faithful to God from Acts chapter number 9. I mean, he forsook everything. He didn't take a wife. He was a tent maker on the side just to have enough money to serve the Lord. He's the reason that you and I, God's the reason, but God used him that we're sitting in East Tennessee in a church today worshiping God, because Paul traveled around the world just telling people about a God who could set them free. Don't you ever wonder, maybe in the prison right before they come in, right before the executioner came in to behead Paul, do you ever wonder if he said, I've been through enough to know that He'll be enough for me? Dear friend, I don't know the storm you're traveling through today. I may not ever know, but He knows. And on a Sunday night, we wasn't scheduled to have service after homecoming. I was sitting on my couch about a month ago, and as clear as I'm talking to you, the Holy Spirit said, Matthew, you need to have service that night. You know what I said? Yes, Lord, we'll do it. And maybe it's just that He sent me tonight to tell somebody that you may be going through a storm, but that He's right there with you. Brother Tommy, Brother Rocky, you help me please close, if you will. Can I finish this chapter up to you? They came to the shore, and in verse 54 of Mark 6, when they were come out of the ship, straightway they knew Him. And they ran through the whole region round about and began to carry about in beds those that were sick where they heard He was. And whosoever, whithersoever He entered into the villages or cities or country, they laid the sick in the streets, and they besought Him that they might touch, if it were but the border of His garment. And as many as touched Him were made whole. When they came to the shore that day, they brought every sick person to Him, just believing that He could heal them. Can you imagine that? I like to think about things. I'm a visual person, Brother John. Can you imagine Jesus stepping out of the boat and all this great crowds of people, bringing the sick, bringing those that just need help? Can you imagine Jesus just touching each of them, healing them, the storms of their life? I thought about John chapter number 5. I thought about the man by the pool of Bethesda. He laid there. Everybody else was getting help. Everybody else, the water, the angel would come down. You remember they would stir the water there outside of Solomon's porch, and the first one in was healed. Happened all day. Here sat this impotent man that couldn't get himself to the water. One day, a man walked by, and he said, would you be made whole? He said, sir, I've got nobody to get me to the water. He said, you don't have to get to the water. You know why? because the fountain of living water was talking to him. And in that moment, I feel it as I'm telling, in that moment, Jesus said, take up your bed and walk. Can you imagine? He stands up for the first time, stretches them legs out, starts to walk back to where he came from. Maybe you feel that way. Maybe we got in a service like today and we's all throwing our hands up and shouting. Maybe you didn't have no shout. Preacher, everybody else is rejoicing, but the storms of my life will just not permit me to rejoice. Dear friend, you know the very way out of a storm? You've got to rejoice your way out of the storm. Worship is not something you always feel like doing, but it's something we're always obligated to do. Because Jesus gave his life upon the cross of Calvary that we might have life. I say it like this tonight and I'm done. Pastor Lee used to say something like, if I'm the lady, he told me one time, he said, if I'm the lady with the blood issue, Lord, let me just touch the hem of your garment. Or Lord, if I'm blind Bartimaeus, just touch me. I wonder tonight, would somebody say, preacher, I need the Lord to do something. I'm going through a storm and I just can't see him. I'm going to invite you tonight to come around an altar. Not so that we can leave and say there's this many people on an altar, but so that we can leave rejoicing. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden, and I will. Did you know? I will give you rest. 1 Peter 5:7, casting all of your care upon him, because he careth for you. Knowing that the trying of your faith, that's much more precious than gold, worketh patience. As we stand to our feet, I'm going to give you this last verse. Paul said in Romans chapter number 8, verse number 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Dear friend, the storm tonight's temporary, but heaven is eternal. Paul said that what you're facing tonight cannot compare to when we all get in that heavenly chorus and sing praises unto the Lamb of God for all of eternity. Tonight, if there's a burden on your heart, you need help of the Lord in your storm, would you come? Would you ask him to help you tonight? Lord, I thank you for this time in your word. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you walk in the midst of the storms of the life with us. Lord, I know this is easier to preach than it is to live. And God, I know that I'll have to live it myself. But God, in the midst of the storms of life, help us still to rejoice. God, whether we're in the dungeon, whether we're in the prison, whether we're in the fiery furnace, God, help us to remember that you're more than enough for us. Father, I pray tonight that you'd help our hearts. Speak to us through your word and draw us to yourself. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you need to come tonight, would you come as we sing?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching for you and for me.
before we go home, this was on my heart earlier. I want to sing What a Day That'll Be. Can you put that up on the screen? And the reason that I do, I'm going to read that verse to you one more time. We'll sing a song. We're going to go home. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Dear friend, there's coming a day when God's going to wipe away every... We won't even remember the storms we've been through. And I want you to sing this tonight just as a reminder, then we'll make our way out of here. Amen. Let's sing it tonight. These altars are still open if you need to pray.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come.
Think about it tonight. Really think about it.
No more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day.
About it.
When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be.
I like this verse. Think about it.
There'll be no sorrow there, no more burdens to bear,
no more storms,
no more sickness, no pain. No more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me.
What a day, glorious day that will be.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day.
Thankful for that amen. Tonight. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. What a day. Anything on your heart before we go home? I've got an announcement to give you, but anything on your heart before that?
I just got a text from Brother DeWayne just a while ago and before church started, and he said that he wants to thank the church for the love offering that was taken up for them this morning. Their project that they're getting ready to do. The new CD that's coming out, the total was going to be about $9,000, and it was about $1,500 short. God supplied that today.
Amen.
So that's a God.
Amen. Amen. Maybe we ought to tell him to put on that record, I've been through enough.
Amen.
To know that he'll be
Amen.
Enough. Amen. Anybody else, anything on your heart before we go home? Choir practice Wednesday night. Anything else? Anybody else? Anything on your heart? Miss Patsy. Amen. Yeah, this Thursday. Finance committee meeting. Anybody else? Be much in prayer for Bible school. That is just around the corner. That starts June 20th through the 24th, 6 to 8:30. We need your help with some things on the table on the way out. I haven't announced it. I failed to because we've had so many things going on, but there's a list. Many of you know what the Isaiah 117 house is that helps in giving the foster children somewhere to stay between being removed and being placed. And what the missions project is this year is to just make backpacks for them to have stuff. So you grab one of these lists and you can go buy some of the stuff, or I'm sure you can make a donation to the church in memo of that, and we'll make sure we use it for that. I'll be praying about Bible school. I'll be praying about Faith Family and Fireworks. Let me give you this announcement. Be here Wednesday night at 6 o'clock if you can. We'll finish up Ruth chapter number 4. Next Sunday, I will be gone on vacation, so you pray for us as we just come apart before we come apart, as the old man of God used to say, and we rest a little while. There'll be two different guest preachers coming through, God willing. Please be here. If you're in town and you can, please don't just take a time out from church. Please be here. Support those preachers. They're going to be praying, and they'll have a word from the Lord. So I'm expecting maybe somebody get saved. I believe that can happen. So you be here. Men, you make sure to take them to the prayer room and pray with them. So you be here for that, and then God willing, I'll be back with you the following Sunday, okay? Father's Day is that Sunday. No service that night. We'll decorate for Bible school. Anything else? Amen. Yeah. Yeah, bring donations if you can, get that list. The last Sunday of every month, starting next month, I haven't told Brother Zach yet, but I need his help building some kind of donation box in the education building, but I'm sure he'll help me. So we'll have that over there for you to put stuff. We're not just going to do it the last day of the month, but that's going to be the projected day to bring stuff, to donate money. But you can bring it. If you want to help Jessica on the Blessing Box team, see her. That thing empties by tonight, by tomorrow. When I get to the office, it'll be empty again. We just got a lot of people, so let's take care of our community the best we can, okay? All hearts and minds clear. You'll be at liberty to go tonight. We'll see you Wednesday night. I love you. The Lord loves you. Thank you for being here. You're at liberty to go.